Hello and welcome to our special members appreciation event featuring Michael Lington. I'm Frank Muller, General Manager of KUNV 91.5 The Source. As we stressed during our recently completed pledge drive, members are the lifeblood of our radio station. Without your support, not only would we not be having this event, but we would not exist. So I'd like to begin by saying thank you for your support and for us, for this station and the wonderfully diverse and enriching programming we offer. We could not do it without you. We're glad that we're able to say thank you by holding events like these, and we're grateful for the generosity of several individuals and organizations that have made this possible, including Cliff and Jason Goroff, Andy Howard, Coca-Cola Bottling of Las Vegas, Earl of Sandwich in downtown Summerlin, and of course, Michael Lington. Michael Lington has had an incredible career in the nearly 20 years since the launch of his debut album, with several Billboard hits of his own, as well as collaborations with stars like Aaron Neville and Michael Bolton. While he tours around the world, we're glad he has made Las Vegas a regular stopping point, and especially thankful that during this visit for Jazz Under the Stars series at Aliante Casino Hotel, he generously agreed to participate in this event. So without further ado, here's Michael Lington.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Michael Lington.
Hello. How are you?
It is so wonderful to see you in person. We've done this on the phone, and we say hello to our viewers and our live audience. I'm Kim Lindsay, morning host, music director at 91.5 The Source. And Michael and I, we do go back a ways. We've had some great phone conversation and interviews. And we welcome you back to Las Vegas.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
Yeah. So last night, Aliante.
Yep.
Saved my indoors right with the ring.
Yeah, right. I know, right?
Yes.
Supposed to be Jazz Under the Stars, and it was Jazz Under the Lights, I guess. We had a great time.
Yes.
Wonderful time. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, it's always a pleasure to have you here in Las Vegas and have you back. I would like to say congratulations to your new release, Second Nature. This, what a beautiful project.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, we had a lot of fun making that record.
Yes. Well, it's your ninth release.
My ninth album, yeah.
Out almost two decades in the business. And
what happened to all the years?
Yes, right? Where did it go? But with this one, your ninth is significant as a number. Would you share with us the mystique behind the number nine, as in?
Well, I mean, you know, you can believe in that or you cannot, mm-hmm. but I mean, the thing about it is every album that I do, I try to make it really special. So. Mm-hmm. I do feel this is a special one because it got me in touch with my roots, if you will. Mm-hmm. Growing up in Copenhagen, I listened to this kind of music,
you
know, and that's what inspired me to mm-hmm. play the saxophone. Mm-hmm. You know, I joke around with my original instrument was actually the clarinet.
Okay, yes.
And I always joke around when I said, if I still played the clarinet, mm-hmm. first of all, you and I probably wouldn't be sitting here mm-hmm. talking. I probably mm-hmm. wouldn't be performing in Las Vegas. Mm-hmm. But no, it was really... soul and rhythm and blues music mm-hmm. coming out of Memphis that got me started with the saxophone and ultimately why I wanted to move to America.
Okay.
So it is a significant record because I feel very connected to it, feel very connected to my instrument, very connected to this kind of music, which is, by the way, why we call that second nature. That's right. It feels mm-hmm. like second nature. And we had so much fun with this record. We mm-hmm. recorded in L.A., recorded in Memphis, recorded in New York. And you know, almost seems like everywhere in between, but yes.
Take us, okay, with this journey with Second Nature, second, as you said, at one with the instrument, take us to the studio with you and the composing part with your, with Barry Eastman.
Yeah,
composed with him on Soul Appeal as a producer.
Well, we were co-writers and also co-writers, he produced Soul Appeal and he produced Second Nature,
So,
well, it's been a we wrote a lot of songs together mm-hmm. because the truth is, starting from Soul Appeal, which came mm-hmm. out in 2014, it was a bit of a departure. I don't want to really say that, but it was mm-hmm. definitely a different direction for me from my previous albums. Okay. So I had this idea and I ran it by Barry. I always wanted to work with him. He is an absolutely fantastic songwriter and producer, has done so many projects that I've been big fans of. And I said, Barry, what would you think about us making an album where we would sort of pay tribute to the amazing soul and rhythm and blues music coming out of Memphis, mm-hmm. but write the whole record, mm-hmm. not do a cover album?
Yes.
And he's like, are you out of your mind? Mm-hmm. You know how hard it is to write those songs because mm-hmm. the songs were simple, but there was mm-hmm. something about them that just mm-hmm. make it feel so good.
Yes.
So how do you make something feel good when there's so much simplicity, you know? Mm-hmm. There's not a lot of chords or things for me to play around with like that, so it all just had to feel really great. So we wrote almost 40 songs for Soul Appeal and another 35 for Second Nature.
Wow.
And the first, you know, the first 5 or 10 songs were us just basically messing around, mm-hmm. trying to find out how we could write these songs that it seemed like they were written in the 60s, you know?
Yes.
But they were indeed just written. Mm-hmm. So once we had all the songs together, we went into the studio, and there was only one way to do this, mm-hmm. and that was get the best musicians you could possibly get together, and we all go in there with these sketches of songs, mm-hmm. and we try one at a time and see what feels the best.
Yes.
And everybody contribute. This is such a collaboration, both Soul Appeal and, of course, Second Nature.
Yes.
So the process of, we went into the studio in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. put together an amazing rhythm section.
Yes.
Ray Parker Jr. on guitar, mm-hmm. Paul Jackson Jr. on guitar, Teddy Campbell on drums, Lenny Castro on percussion, Freddie Washington on bass, mm-hmm. and Barry Eastman on mm-hmm. Wurlitzer and Fender Rhodes. Mm-hmm. And then for Second Nature, I said, let's up the ante a little bit. Mm-hmm. why don't we go to Memphis and record there?
So you went to Memphis.
So I went to Memphis, yes. And I'd been to Memphis before, a few months earlier, because I was invited to play at the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville. And I said, let's go by Memphis. I want to check out the Stax Museum and sort of really saturate, get it in me of what this was all about.
Yes.
So I went to visit this amazing studio, Royal Studios, which is the house, or I should say the home of Al Green.
Yes.
And was recently discovered by Mark Ronson, because it turns out that Bruno Mars recorded Uptown Funk in there as well.
Okay.
Yeah. So I went in there, and it's still owned by the gentleman that found Al Green and produced all his record, Willie Mitchell. He passed away some years ago, and his son operates it now. And I said, his name is Boo. I don't really think that's his name, but Boo Mitchell. So I said, Boo, help me put this together.
Yes.
You know, I want the real deal, the real deal. So we put together half of Al Green's band and half of the remaining members of Stax rhythm section.
Wow.
We added the Memphis horns, and then we added Booker T. Jones.
Yes.
And then we had ourselves a nice little R&B and soul record, do you know what I mean? And then we went to New York and recorded with the Dap Kings, which, by the way, you know, I've been a fan of for many years, Sharon Jones. But most people actually know them from Amy Winehouse, because they, also Mark Ronson produced many of those songs and used the Dap Kings. So, you know, we added Taylor Dane on vocals, another beautiful vocalist, Cy Smith, who did such a great job. And we just had fun doing this.
It sounds like you had fun. I mean, the horns, if you love horns, this is the project.
Yeah, there's a lot of horns on there.
It's horns, but up energy. I was driving and listening, and this is totally
I mean, I love horns.
Yes.
Now I understand why singers love their background vocalists so much, because having a horn section behind you when you play is just an absolutely blast. Mm-hmm. Barry was a little concerned there was too many horns, so I had to fight. Keep them all.
Producer.
We made a good compromise. Mm-hmm. He took out a couple of them here or there, but I'm really happy about it. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, I am so proud and so proud to know you, and so proud to present your music to our listeners, because it's just stellar. And we talk about the Dap Kings. What did you get from working with each artist? Like, how did you hook up with Booker T. Jones?
Well, we had recorded Beale Street in Los Angeles, the rhythm section. Mm-hmm. Then we had added the horns, the Memphis horns, in Memphis.
Okay.
And the song, I'm sitting listening to it and going, there's only thing it's missing.
Yes.
And that's Booker T.
Yes.
So, and also, you know, Booker and the MGs, those are somebody I listened to growing up. So, Ray Parker, I know that Ray knew him. Mm-hmm. I said, can you get me a hold of Booker? I'd love him to play on the record.
Yes.
And we did, and we heard nothing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then, very persistent, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
So we kept on going at it. And finally, I got a message from his manager, which also happens to be his daughter.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And says, I understand you're trying to get a hold of Booker. Mm-hmm. And I did. I said, look, I have this project, and it's the real thing.
Yes.
And first of all, before we even talk about it, I said, I want to play it for you, because I think you'll hear. And he's very busy, and he's doing this, and I don't know if it's possible. But send it over. We'll see what we can do.
Yes.
I send it over. I get a phone call back, like, within 10 minutes. Oh, he'd love to do it, you know.
Beautiful.
So, yeah. So it was like that. And then he lives in Lake Tahoe or Reno, and came down to L.A., and we recorded his organ in a studio in Los Angeles where they had an organ that he had played on before, both him and Billy Preston.
Wow.
And turns out that he is one of the nicest people you can ever meet, one of the most talented. I just can't say enough about him. Such a joy, such a pleasure having him on the album, and be able to meet with him and do our thing. It's so great.
Well, congratulations
Thank
on that
you.
Score. Yes. But your friends, and we speak of Ray Parker Jr.,
right.
Taylor Dane. I mean, these are your friends also.
It's good to have talented friends.
Yes, it is.
Right? Yeah, it really is. It's very helpful.
It is.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, no, it's great. But I mean, because when you're friends with these type of people, and you know, it makes it a little easier to get things done, if you know what I mean. And, if they're, you know, it's just, and they're great people. So we love hanging out and, you know.
Did you select them because you felt that they would bring something specific to your project?
I only selected them as my friends because I knew they could play on my record. No, not exactly.
Just checking.
No. We met first, obviously, mm-hmm. under probably different circumstances and sort of became friends. And then, you know, as you go on to make these albums, you think, what would be a great fit? You know, mm-hmm. what's interesting about Taylor Dayne is that most people think of her as more of a pop singer, yeah. right? Very, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. not so much soul and rhythm and blues, but she is at heart a soul singer.
I mean, in a big way.
That was she grew up listening to. And then a career took her a little bit on a different path. Mm-hmm. But I tell you, you would think she had been singing soul her entire life. She just brings it like that.
Yes, she's on. And we're going to go and talk about the second segment about the tracks. But she does. She handles the song, and she sounds so good. It's built for her.
Yeah. Well, we wrote the song together. Barry and I had an idea for a song, and I asked Taylor if she would be interested to be a part of the album. She said, absolutely. So I said, why don't you come and write with us and finish writing the song, and we can, we'll sing it. We all, we'll have a good time doing it. And that's what we did. She came over to the house. Yes. We had a martini. Then we started writing.
Yeah. Well, that helps. Yeah.
Yeah, it always, things going,
Surely. Yeah. Yes. So by way of Copenhagen, I mean, this music sounds like it lives in you, Michael. I mean, the soul and that sound.
Yeah. Well, but that's me, though. I mean, that's always what sort of, it's funny, we talked about Taylor Howe. She's an R&B singer and went on a pop path. You know, I grew up listening to this. So it is so deep mm-hmm. inside of me that it really, mm-hmm. it feels very effortless. I shouldn't say that because, I mean, you mm-hmm. have to really like writing the songs mm-hmm. was quite of a challenge. But, mm-hmm. but I mean, it just feels so natural for me to do. So mm-hmm. I, even though I've made other kind of records, like Show Me and You and I, which is a little more on the pop side, but I've always had an R&B soul thing about my playing and my personality, I think.
Yes, and then you definitely demonstrate. I just keep doing this because I want listeners.
You can just keep it there the whole time.
To see Second Appeal. I mean, it's smoking, and I can't say hi enough regards. Let's go back just a minute before we go into our next song. But you started with Bobby Caldwell. Early in your career, part of the section, the horn section of Bobby?
No, I was, he actually never had a horn section. Mm-hmm. He had a featured sax player, and he had many fine sax players before me. You know, he had funny he always would say this, that his show or gig mm-hmm. was a springboard for sax players. And it really was. In the 80s, it was Dave Koss, mm-hmm. and then it was Richard Elliott, and then it was Boney James, which I took over from in, I think, 1994. Mm-hmm. And but that's really how I got introduced to the jazz and the contemporary jazz format, because prior to that, I was just living in L.A. I was young. I had just come over. I didn't really know what I was doing. As a matter of fact, I thought I would just be in LA working, mm-hmm. playing music, and maybe going on a tour like I did. I had no idea that eventually I would be making albums and write music. It was actually Bobby that said, you know what, you should make a record, like a couple of years in.
Nice.
And said, you should make a record. And I said, wow, that sounds great. I'd love to do that. But what do we do? He says, I don't know. We'll figure it out. You know, but do it before the curtain closes. You know, he says, do it quick.
Nice.
So I said, that's a great idea, but will you mm-hmm. sing on the album?
Yes.
And he said, yes. Well, I asked him about 100 times too, but eventually he said yes. Okay. So we came up, he said, well, what do you do? What should we do? And I said, why don't we do this song we always would do mm-hmm. when we sound check? Mm-hmm. Tell It Like It Is.
A classic.
Classic, yes. You know, and he says, that's a great idea. So we did it. And mm-hmm. honestly, neither one of us had any idea that not only was it a top 10 on the jazz charts, but it was also a top 20 on the pop charts. And because of that, this is my first record. One day I was on the Dick Clark show, mm-hmm. on the radio show, and he called me, and he was like, it was like unreal. You know, and so it was really great to mm-hmm. get my start with Bobby.
Absolutely.
And he taught me a lot about showmanship as well.
Yes, Mr. Yeah. Showmanship.
One of the things he said, I've never said that, one of the things he said, which is very funny, he says, if you decide to get off the stage and go mm-hmm. play into the audience, make sure you know your way back to the stage. You know what? I never forget that. So yes, I was looking where the steps are, because there's times you get off and you jump off and then you realize there's actually no stairs. Mm-hmm. And also you're like, you go back on and you're like, you know, and you try to climb on a stage, you know, it's not a pretty thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It sounds very interesting. We'd love to hear another song from you.
Yeah, like, of course.
You did Road Trip. Maybe hear something like Soul Appeal, maybe?
Why don't we do something from Soul Appeal? This is sort of how this type of sound for me got started. And this song was also a really, really important song for me. It actually stayed at number one for 16 weeks on the charts.
Congrats.
I want to do that right now, Soul Appeal.
Excellent. Michael Lington, everyone. Hey. Yes, that's why I was on the chart for 16 years.
That sort of feels like an Al Green kind of song, doesn't it?
It does.
Yes.
It does. And it's a hit. And
thank you very much. Thank you. It's fun to play. It really is. It
yes.
really is, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's in your what? I would like to go over some of the songs that we spoke about Taylor Dane, but Cy Smith,
yes.
a fan of Masai. How did she meet Cy Smith?
You know, I originally met her just touring, and she's been mm-hmm. singing with my buddy Chris Bode
yes.
for a long time. And every time I see her, she just amazes me. Mm-hmm. She is so cool, first of all. She's mm-hmm. one of the coolest people I know.
Okay.
And she looks great,
yes.
and she sounds great, mm-hmm. and we sort of became friends. And I forgot where we really connected, but there was one, mm-hmm. it might have been on one of those jazz cruises mm-hmm. yes. where Chris was on, and she uh-huh. was on there as well, and we had a whole week,
yes.
nobody getting off the ship, mm-hmm. we're just hanging out, mm-hmm. you know, and I think that that's where we sort of really connected. And when I came back, I remember I did a small residency at a jazz club mm-hmm. in Beverly Hills. They had just opened, and they asked me to do a monthly show. Mm-hmm. But I put together a show which was more of an all-star jam night, if you will. I mean, I would start mm-hmm. doing my set, mm-hmm. and then I would invite mm-hmm. my talented friends.
Yes.
You know, so that was like the whole setup mm-hmm. of the thing. So we had sort of so like a celebrity night, if you will. So I had Taylor yes. Dane, I had yes. Bill Chamblin, I had Howard Hewitt, I had Elliot Yameen, Ray Parker came down, of course, and I forgot, but just mm-hmm. the whole, I called everybody,
mm-hmm.
you know. So mm-hmm. One of the people I called was Cy. I said, why don't you come down and sing a song? And
yes.
she came down, and I mean, the place stood still.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I said, okay, mm-hmm. more to come mm-hmm. right there. Mm-hmm. So when it came time to do this album, there was a song that Barry Eastman and myself and Syeda Garrett had written.
Yes.
And I said, Cy would be perfect to sing that song.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what she did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Some Kind of Way.
Some Kind of Way.
And it's one of the ballads on
yeah.
this up-tempo, really funky date.
Yeah.
And then you have a beautiful ballad that's sitting here.
Well, you gotta have yeah. something mm-hmm. to offset all mm-hmm. the funk a little bit. You know, I mean, it's
yes.
it's nice to have something that really drops down, but still mm-hmm. keeps it, you know, very
yes.
soulful and
Absolutely.
Intense. But
yes.
but her voice is just, mm-hmm. you know, yeah. amazing, mm-hmm. amazing, yes.
I just recently got hip to Masai within the last few years, so I was so happy to
yeah.
see her on your date. So Brian Culberson, you and he have worked together in other projects, but you feature him on a track called Slick.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
right, exactly,
yes.
yeah.
Uh-huh.
Well, I mean, most people obviously know Brian as a keyboardist, and, mm-hmm. and but I mean, many of the folks that have seen his shows know that he will chase, mm-hmm. he's known to chase saxophone players around the stage with a trombone. Yeah,
play.
Yeah, and I've been on the receiving end of that for many years.
Mm-hmm.
About this close, actually,
oh,
yeah.
Yeah,
oh. yeah so, so when you see me smile, it's actually pain. It's a pure, no. Anyway, so Brian and I have been buddies for a long time. We've written many songs together. As a matter of fact, the first song I played today, Road Trip, mm-hmm. is a song that he and I wrote together.
Okay, yes.
And, but it goes way back to Still Thinking of You mm-hmm. and Off the Hook. And so I wanted to feature Brian on the trombone on my record instead of mm-hmm. on the keyboards.
Yes.
And I basically just called him and saying, why don't we record something together? And he says, I'd love to. Mm-hmm. So he came and played trombone on Slick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sounds
which is kind of like a mm-hmm. James Brownish kind of feeling song,
yes,
you know?
It is. Yeah. Yes, it
yeah.
is. So and I get a kick out of Woo. It's
oh,
right
woo.
There.
No. Yeah,
woo.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
it's in the title.
Well,
the
that's woo. A very funny story. That's Ray, that's my buddy Ray Parker Jr. I have to tell you a really, really funny story.
Okay.
And that is he came over. He was going to play guitar on my album, mm-hmm. and he came over to my house, and he basically shows up in his convertible car,
mm-hmm, yes.
him sitting in the one seat, and this guitar sticking out of the other seat,
mm-hmm.
and basically, no case, no nothing,
mm-hmm.
and he says, where do I park? I said, well, you know, it's a little hard to park on my street. He says, okay, we got to write a hit. And that way we can get your new house with more parking. So that's how we came up with, yeah. So we went in and wrote. So you had an initial idea and, you know, and that's how we did it. And then we ended up recording it when we were all tracking it down.
It's really catchy, really catchy song. And before we wrap, because I'm going to move over to the slide, I want to share with our listeners, because we always get a chance to talk about this.
Right.
Not only are you an award-winning producer, musician, and great player, you're also a businessman. And I love talking to you about this because you have ventures. So you have your cigar line, right. You have your winery, and now I read that you're going to do maybe endorse mouse.
Well, yeah. Yes. I mean, I don't have my own winery. I have my own line of wines. Yeah. Uh-huh. And I work with an amazing winery up in Paso Robles, California.
Yes.
I have a cigar company. I have my own line of cigars too. I mean, yes. it's they're made in Honduras. And then I started making my mouthpieces because I couldn't find another replacement mouthpiece for the one I had.
Yes.
So I got together with the guy that made my original one. I said, why don't we make one together? And I would just get emails, and he did too, about that mouthpiece. How do we get it? How do we get it from fans and other sax players? And so I said, let's make one and just make it available. So in that way, I have extra ones.
Yes.
And also, it'll be available to the people that want it. So that's kind of how that came about. Yeah.
Yes. What do you do for, I mean, do you have downtime? Or,
I mean, well, like, I mean, really? You know, it's yes. like, not much, you know, between uh-huh, yes. songwriting uh-huh. and let's see, you know, recording the album, mm-hmm. touring,
yes.
doing the wine, cigars, mm-hmm. mouthpieces thing. I don't know, mm-hmm. you know, play a little yeah. tennis maybe, mm-hmm. you know.
Yes. I like to honor your grandfather because I know he was a great influence in your life. Before we wrap up, would you share a little bit about his influence in your life?
Well, I mean, he was my mentor, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't think I would. He exposed me to the music business, but mm-hmm. also he was just. I loved his life, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. I saw it very early on. Yeah. As a matter of fact. He was a pretty big deal mm-hmm. in Denmark, and he would always get invited to the newest, the premieres and all that stuff, mm-hmm. and he would bring me, and I was a little kid, and I just was in awe of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And then at his house, it was always people calling, musicians calling. It always seemed like a party, mm-hmm. you know?
Yes. Yes.
So I was just, I think very early on, it was mm-hmm. just really maybe infatuated with his career
yes.
and kind of wanted that for me, I think. Mm-hmm. I mean, without even knowing it at the time, but
yes.
it was just,
uh-huh.
it just seems like that was what I was supposed to be doing, mm-hmm. you know.
Absolutely.
So,
yes.
Otto Lington. Yeah.
And had the pleasure to meet your father also, who's
my father's
Otto.
Here. Yeah, he's visiting me. Mm-hmm. He loves coming to the U.S. Mm-hmm. To have fun. It's very funny, by the way. We try to plan a trip mm-hmm. every year, right?
Yes.
Comes to visit. But he always just asked me when I'm the busiest, because I said, well, I've been very busy. I have a week off. He says, no, I don't want to come there. I want to come when you're busy, because he wants to be a part of everything, mm-hmm. you know?
Yes.
So he always plans his trip on when I got a bunch of stuff going on. So I think it's very funny because I want to relax with him, hang out, and he mm-hmm. has nothing to do with it.
Yes.
He's 82 years old. He just wants to go. So
it's a beautiful thing. I have so appreciate really seeing you in person and having a chance to chat with you. And I hope our listeners and our viewers up close and personal. And I'm going to move out the way. So before I get out the chair, would you share with listeners and viewers and our audience how they can find out more about your product lines?
Of course. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, a great destination is my website, mm-hmm. michaellington.com, mm-hmm. because I kind of keep everything. You can go to Michael Lington
yes.
Cigars. You
yes.
can go to Michael, I'm not Michael Lington Wine, but it's Lington mm-hmm. Wine. See, it's hard to remember mm-hmm. all the different.
Yes.
So go to michaellington.com, and then there is, you can find out everything. But,
excellent.
Of course, I'm on social media,
yes.
Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. We gotta be everywhere.
Yeah, you
know,
we
gotta, you know, there's a lot of choices, and people want mm-hmm. to all have their own ideas mm-hmm. of where they want to find you. So
absolutely.
The website is a good place, and of course, Facebook or any of the social media
okay.
networks is good.
Well, it's been an honor, and thank you again so much for coming
thank
in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Of course, thank
and
you.
And my colleague John Ashton will be with you next.
Okay,
so
wonderful.
May I just
of course. So great. Thank you.
I appreciate you. Thank you, Michael Lington. He's going to perform another song, and we're going to hear.
Well, you know, I wanted to do a song that that I usually don't do. Mm-hmm. It's a song that came off a 2006 album called A Song for You.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a very different record. It was an album I did with a full orchestra. So I thought it'd be really nice to do a song from that album. It's a little bit of a different feel, actually very much a different feel than what I've been doing.
But thank you, Michael
thank
Lington.
Thank you.
Michael Lincoln.
Sure. Hey, how are you? How you doing, Michael?
Great to see you.
John Nashen.
Hello, John.
Those of you that may or may not know me, I'm the afternoon drive guy that you put up with every day, Monday through Friday.
And I'm sure they love you.
Well, I try. You mentioned your grandfather.
Yes.
My grandfather was a percussionist.
Wonderful.
And your grandfather may have crossed paths in the United States with him if he ever came over due to things like working with Paul Whiteman.
Right.
And things like that he did. And in the 50s and 60s, some great American jazz players moved to Denmark.
Well, yeah. Not only that, but a lot of them also toured over there. And my grandfather was sort of known, him and his orchestra was known to back up a lot of them and record with
That's
a lot of them.
That's
great. He did, I think, 3 or 4 records with the Mills Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And he worked Fats Waller.
Yeah.
That's great. Jovanotti and Shirley Bassey. Yeah. I mean, so it was, there was the stories that he was telling me about all those days.
Oh, yeah.
I think that really got me hooked. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I have memories of the phone always ringing in my house.
Right. Exactly.
And it was great.
Yeah.
And because of my family situation was that my grandfather, my uncle, and I all play.
Right.
And they would, when I got into college, the phone call was always, is there a drummer in the house?
Right.
You know, because they needed somebody.
Right.
And it's great to have that kind of thing, you know, and America lost one of their best drummers. Ed Thigpen went to Denmark with Oscar Peterson and never came home.
Is that right? Yeah.
He liked the way he was treated over there.
A few of them lived there.
So he stayed. And you worked with Michael Bolton.
I did, yes.
You don't look like one of the Sugar Horns.
Oh, this was after the Sugar Horns. That's funny you should say that. Yeah, no, he used to
Jesse
have,
J
a,
yeah,
he used to have a female
Kiko.
Horn section.
Yeah.
And right after that, he changed his band out and was looking for somebody that could sort of do a spot in the middle of his show from a sax player because he, you know, the way he had done his set, he went back and he had to do a wardrobe change, and then he would, for the song he continued with after the break, he would start out in the audience.
Sure.
So there was a little break there. He needed somebody to sort of take over. So I came down and met with him in Los Angeles, and he heard my record. At the time, it was might have been Heat, my album Heat, and he heard and played him a couple of things, and we rehearsed a little bit. And he said, "That's great. Why don't you come on the road with me?" But it'll only be 6 weeks. Yeah, it was 3 years. Yeah, that's how it works.
You know, it's funny how that works, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
I did playing gigs like that where you take one, you feel, I'll do this for a while, and then years later you're going, I need to get out of here.
Yeah.
You know,
it just happens that
on.
Way. I mean, we had a lot of fun, and you know, Michael was extremely generous with me. You know, he brought me out. He says, you know, usually my schedule, I do one day on, one day off. So in the day off, go and see radio, go and shake hands with people, promote your career. I'll be flying you around, use my band, you know, sell your CDs at my shows, go out and meet my fans. So
it
really was a great, great opportunity for me. And again, there's a reason why it lasted 3 years, supposed to. And we could have probably lasted 20 years, to be honest with you. But Michael loves the tour.
Did he have you on the softball team, too?
No, he didn't do that. That was early on. I know he had a Bolton, right?
It
was,
yeah.
But... But yeah, no, that was before me. I think that was quite some time before me. But as a matter of fact, when I was with him, he did Dancing with the Stars, you remember, and a lot of other.
Mm-hmm.
He always and he did that Saturday Night Live skit.
Yeah.
Jack Sparrow, Captain with, with the Lonely Island guys, and always he always. You know what's amazing with Michael is he's incredible at sort of. Making himself constantly current and in the media sort of reinventing himself. You know, again, he's a guy that is known for, well, he started out his career as a heavy metal musician, a singer in a heavy metal band. Then he had another band called Blackjack. And then he made soul music all suddenly and came out with Soul Provider.
Sure.
Next thing you know, he's doing an opera album.
Yeah.
You know, and so he's brilliant.
He is. There's a couple of those. Sting is another one like that. Now, the other thing I wanted to ask you about, someone had asked me why you did the switch from clarinet to saxophone.
Well, I mean, again, it's a pretty easy thing to answer because I fell in love with soul and rhythm and blues music listening on the radio. And there was no clarinet in that music, turns out.
No.
But there was lots of saxophone.
Oh,
Junior Walk on the All-Stars, King Curtis.
Yeah, Tower of Power.
Yeah, I mean, I was a huge fan of David Sanborn, and he, you know, it was jazz, funk, R&B, everything, you know. So I fell in love with the horn. And as a teenager, I just kind of fell out of love with the clarinet, if you will. You
know? Yeah. Alto, tenor, which one do you
Well,
like?
My first instrument was alto.
Yeah.
And then I had a funny kick. As soon as I came to the United States, I was done with the alto. It was all tenor. Until I met Bobby Caldwell, and he is not a big fan of the tenor. Mm-hmm. At least wasn't at the time. As a matter of fact, it was so funny because all his records were all the solos on his albums were all alto solos.
Yeah.
Even with players that are known for playing tenor, like Richard Elliott, mm-hmm. he made him play alto. So when I started with Bobby, it was all alto. And therefore, for 4 years, I pretty much did all alto, and we were just on tour together. And I felt I felt so connected to my horn at that point that it became my number one horn, and it became my voice, if you will, for my solo records.
Mm-hmm.
I ventured out and did a couple of songs on some earlier albums on soprano sax. But one of them actually was a hit for me, a song called Sunset Port of Soul.
Sure.
That was me playing soprano sax. And but after that, that was pretty much the
You
end
play
of that.
Soprano well. Not many do. Many have tried.
That might be a stretch.
It's an elusive instrument.
I know how to hold it.
Well, it's an elusive instrument for a lot of people, especially the little curved one.
Soprano sax is not an easy instrument to play, I find, you know. But anyway, alto, I just feel so, it feels good to me.
Now, a lot of alto sax players I know love playing baritone sax.
Yeah, that wouldn't be me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the baritone sax player is the guy I think that has the most fun in Tower of Power. Because it plays in between all the figures.
That's right. You're absolutely right. Yeah. As a matter of fact, we used Doc, who I actually just saw a couple of weeks ago. We did a show together in Colorado Springs for Old Clues Weekend of Jazz there. And they were on the bill as well. But on my new album, Second Nature, you know, we used the Memphis horns.
Right.
And the Barry's very prominent
there. Very.
And there's a song on the album called Memphis Strut.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a Barry feature, if you will. There's no solos, but him going bow, throughout the whole song. And it's such a cool effect.
Yeah,
so I let guys like that do the Barry.
You know, a lot of guys I know that have done big band jazz work like baritone, because basically you're the alto sax at octave low.
Yeah.
And they feel like they can control the lead alto player, where the tenor players can't usually do that.
Okay,
I worked with a great tenor sax player for a few years, for Don Menza.
Oh, okay, great.
And you should hear him play alto.
Right.
He gets almost like a tenor saxophone sound on the alto. It's very fat.
Well, that's always what I've tried to do with my alto sound,
you do.
Too. I try to get, it almost sounds like a cross between a tenor and an alto, because alto can get a little bright and a little, little pinchy or thin, if you will.
Yeah.
And that's just the nature of the instrument. And I try to counteract that with anything I can, you know, with the way I approach it, and the type of reed mouthpiece I use, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I've listened to people play live shows and things where they start going into the high range and you want to go like...
Yeah.
And you have a very beautiful sound when you go for the high
range. Well,
notes.
I still go in the high range,
The altissimo is hard to play.
I have fun up there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, if you don't have a really great reed, you're in trouble up there, that's for sure.
Yeah, I'm always amazed at some of the dexterity that you guys have with registers on the horn.
Yeah, I think we have fun up there.
You do. And by the way, I love the choice of Booker T. It added just the right flavor to Beale Street.
So I talked about the story getting Booker T on there. I actually tried to get Steve Cropper on the album too, but that one didn't work out. So maybe the next one we'll try that one. But
I remember Booker T was on a talk show at one point. This was maybe 15 years ago or longer.
Right.
And the host asked him what he was up to, and he said, "My name is Booker T, and I'm available."
Is that right?
yeah. Which was interesting, because Booker T and the MGs something I grew up on.
Of course. But you know what? Then at the end of the day, you know, he started out as a musician. He was just a session player at Stax Records, you know. And Green Onions came about them messing around in between tags.
Sure.
For, you know, he was basically the house band for Stax Records.
Mm-hmm.
And he toured, I think he was... was he Otis Redding's recording band?
He was.
And yeah, so when they were in there recording with... I don't know if it was Wilson Pickett or Otis Redding, they had some downtime in the studio and they were messing around, and that's how Green Onions came about. You know the song Green Onions? And then Stax thought, oh, that's a really cool song. Why don't we release that? And also it became a huge hit for Booker T and the MGs. And so at the end of the day, he's a musician who wants to play and have fun, like all of us.
He
just happens to be a little more famous than most, but
And I want to thank you for coming in. It's really nice of you to do this with us.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
And I love seeing that our people are interested, and I want to do, we're going to be doing more of these as we go along. And you sound great.
Thank you.
Your album's great.
I appreciate that.
I still call them albums.
Well, they are albums.
Yeah, they are.
An album, by definition, is a collection of or a compilation of things, and, right? Pictures or songs, and that's what it is.
And people call me all the time for requests.
Yeah.
I have a request.
Right.
Will you close with Beale Street?
Oh, I'd be happy to,
Good, thank you.
Absolutely.
And you have a great day, and thanks for coming out.